The tepuis do differ in a number of geologic and physiographic details, and many physical differences can be seen between the eastern and western parts of southern Venezuela. The strata of Cerro Duida are extensively folded, as are those of the western plateaus, especially Cerro Neblina, whilst the strata of the eastern tepuis, like Mount Roraima, are almost entirely horizontal and more uniform in composition. On Cerro Duida, the green variant of Heliamphora tatii has evolved a unique strategy to compete with the dense vegetation amidst which it grows. It forms an erect woody stem which elevates the leaf rosette up to 2 meters into the air. The dead leaves soon break away from the stem, so that 50 centimeters beneath the leaf rosettes the stems are naked and cane-like. On Cerro Duida, Heliamphora tatii frequently grows with Heliamphora macdonaldae, and hybrids between the two species may occur. The pictures of Heliamphora macdonaldae are extremely beautiful. The pitcher opening is lined with variable red or purple veins and suffuses pure red in some strains. This beautiful coloration is highly variable. Heliamphora macdonaldae rarely form a short decumbent stem similar to that of Heliamphora neblinae and very different from that of Heliamphora tatii. The range of Heliamphora chimantensis is known to include the summits of Chimanta and Apacara tepuis at the center of the Chimanta massif. A unique tendency of this species is to continually produce offshoots and form gigantic, densely packed cushions of pitchers, which can consist of several hundred individual plants up to 6 meters in diameter. Heliamphora chimantensis readily hybridizes with Heliamphora pulchella. Lidoternus decumbens is a small, heather-like plant producing secretions of extremely sticky resinous glue from specialized stalked glands, similar to the sticky secretions of Roridula. It is probable that the sticky glands of the flower stalks evolved as a mechanism of defense, exactly as in the case of Passiflora or Stellidium. But the insect-trapping properties of Lithotamnus are considerably more effective. Indeed, so effective are the glands that the flower stalks are often coated in dead arthropods. However, it is impossible for the resinous secretions to contain enzymes useful for the digestion of trapped insects, since enzyme activity can only take place in polar acid aqueous systems, such as the mucus of Drosera, but not within non-polar resinous systems. But Lithotamnus can be seen to perhaps exemplify a possible pre-carnivorous stage. Heliamphora ex appendiculata frequently grows rooted directly to the sides of bare, mossy cliffs of narrow valleys and river gorges, especially where waterfalls and seepage ensures that the rock face is permanently wet. Its name refers to the apparent lack of a nectar spoon lid in this species. Perhaps in compensation for the diminutive apex nectaries, the exterior of the leaf is lined with up to 30, 1 or 2 millimeter long, circular red nectar glands, which effectively attract ground insects and other prey. Heliamphora haberi is closely related to Heliamphora heterodoxa, but is lacking the drainage hole present in most species of Heliamphora at the transition zone between the hairy upper part and the glabrous ventricose water-filled part. Heliamphora uncinata is closely related to Heliamphora ex appendiculata and share the same growth habit. The epithet uncinata refers to the distinctive hook-shaped pitcher appendage, which is unique in the genus. Eliamphora pulchella occurs in a wide variety of habitats, ranging from shallow marshy ponds to the margin of the Bonnetia cloud forest. In the typical variety, the interior of the middle and upper sections of the leaf is lined with very prominent, white 3 to 7 mm long hairs, and also a much denser set of 0.1 to 0.5 mm long hairs. The two types of hairs occur together and dominate most parts of the interior surface of the leaf, down to the midsection of the pitcher. A third set of 1 to 2 mm long hairs forms a dense white band just above the waterline. In some rare strains of Helianthera pulchella, one or two sets of hairs can be altogether absent. The specific epithet folliculata is derived from the Latin follicus, translated small bag or purse, and refers to the distinctive bubble-like nectar-storing structure present on the back of the pitcher. The range of Helianthera folliculata consists of the summits of the remote Los Testigos chain with harsh climatic conditions, and like Helianthera elongata, it becomes established mainly in the shelter of low-growing grasses in well-drained sunny locations. Helianthera zarazinioides predominantly grows amidst short marsh grasses in full sunlight in extremely wet and humid conditions. Its name refers to the similarities between this species and those in the genus Zarazinia. The range of Helianthera zarazinioides consists only of the summit of this mountain. Here it is known to naturally hybridize only with Helianthera heterodoxa. The range of Helianthera heterodoxa encompasses the distant Ptari Tepui as well as several summits within the Chimanta Massif. However, it also occurs in wet patches of the lowland savanna from close to the base of Ptari Tepui eastwards, towards and possibly into Guyana. How time flies! Our CP tour with Stuart McPherson is ending here, and only two Helianthera species are still missing to complete this documentary of the genus in its natural habitat. We are deeply grateful to be able to show some photos of the missing Helianthera at this place by courtesy of Dr. Andreas Wistuber. Thanks a lot, Andreas. The specific epithet Hispida is derived from the Latin hispidus and means bristly. The name refers to the lining of coarse hairs that is present on the interior of the pitchers. The occurrence of Helianthera hispida is restricted to the southern part of the Neblina range on the border between Venezuela and Brazil. Helianthera ciliata can easily be distinguished by the arrangement of prominent hairs on the back of the pitcher and the tufted, deciduous, ciliate white hairs on the pitcher appendage. Finally, at the end of this film, we show now briefly all known species of the genus Heliamphora once again, but in alphabetical order. At this point, our film showed actually all 18 species of the genus Heliamphora published until the year 2010 in their natural habitat. For those of our audience who like to learn more about the Venezuelan tepuis, we warmly recommend Lost Worlds of the Guiana Highlands, the first and only comprehensive study of the remarkable natural history and discovery of the Guiana Highlands. For those who like to read everything worth knowing on the fascinating pitcher plants, we suggest Pitcher Plants of the Americas, also written by Stuart McPherson. To this, we show finally a brief description. Pitcher Plants of the Americas is an informative, visually rich overview of the five genera of pitcher plants that occur in North, Middle, and South America. A group that includes three genera of true pitcher plants, Darlingtonia, Heliamphora and Sarracenia, and two genera of carnivorous tank bromeliads, Brocchinia and Catopsis. Written in clear yet substantive language, the book contains spectacular photography that provides a comprehensive visual record of the group. This book will appeal to both general readers and experts who are interested in the natural history, conservation, and horticulture of the American pitcher plants.